Guys, welcome back to my channel. If you're visiting my channel for the first time, I'm Dr. Tunde Thompson. I've written OET and I passed, and I'm currently awaiting. I've also written PLAB 1, I'm awaiting PLAB 2 beyond Corona lockdown. So, if you're visiting for the first time, I've actually done a lot of videos on writing, listening, reading, and speaking. I would advise you to subscribe to my channel. Kindly hit on this subscribe button and you'll be subscribed. Anytime I release any video, you will have access to all of them. So, let's quickly go to what we have today. Previously, we discussed the errors some candidates commit in their address, date, greeting, and heading. And those errors, we regard those errors to be trivial errors. But today we'll be discussing the main errors, which are the content and structural errors. But we'll be starting with the introduction, the errors that we make in the introduction. So let's assume this is our patient case note, the case note of the patient we are using today. Some candidates make this error we call misinformation or giving out false or inaccurate information. This is the last part of the patient case note, and we are writing a referral letter to a casualty officer, and we are suspecting that our patient has pneumonia, and our patient has been treated severally for asthma. At the beginning of the case note, anyway, I didn't take that part. The patient has both depression, hypertension, and asthma, and we've been managing this patient very well for a very long time. Of recent, the patient now started having features that are suggestive of pneumonia. So let's see how some students give wrong information or inaccurate information. Let's look at this first statement. This first statement here, I'm writing to refer Ms. Jones, a 58-year-old farmer whose clinical features are in keeping with pneumonia. So this patient said that the clinical features, this candidate said the clinical features of these patients are in keeping with pneumonia, but our case notes say, from our case note, we are not sure if the patient has pneumonia. The clinical features are suggesting that this patient has pneumonia. So this introduction is wrong because it gave inaccurate information. It's giving inaccurate information. This second introduction, I'm writing to refer Ms. Jones, a 58-year-old farmer who has been suffering from asthma and was currently diagnosed with pneumonia. Yes, we are currently suspecting that our patient has pneumonia. We've not actually diagnosed that this patient has pneumonia. So this is a misinformation. Another error here. Your expert assessment and management would be appreciated. In medical field, experts are those that are specialized, those medical personnel, nurses, doctors, and any other health professional that is specialized. For example, a specialized theater nurse, a theater nurse is a specialized nurse, a gastroenterologist is a specialized doctor that deals with GIT problems. But a medical casualty officer is not a specialized doctor. So using expert is actually wrong. So this first introduction can be corrected this way: whose clinical features are suggestive of pneumonia? Why the second introduction can be corrected this way: who has been suffering from asthma and is currently being suspected to have pneumonia? So any of these two statements are correct. So let's see another error. The second error, some students are not polite in their writing. This is a formal letter, and whenever you are making a request, you should be polite. Here, we are requesting that this addressee should evaluate and treat our patient, and this candidate used will, which is wrong. You should use would. Here again, your assessment and management will be appreciated. It should be would be appreciated. Whenever you are making a request, you should be polite enough to use will. This statement is not grammatically wrong, but it's rude. So now, anyway, you will not now say that anywhere you see will in your writing, you will not start changing them to would. It does not follow. For instance, if you are referring to the patient, let's say you are saying Miss Jones will be visiting a physiotherapist next week, you should use will and not would. If you use would in that statement will be wrong. So it's only when you are making a request, that's when you change your will to would. Now let's look at this an error addressing our patient wrongly. This patient's name is Angela Jones, and she's 58 years old. Whenever you want to address your patient, whenever you're addressing your patient in your writing, you should use the patient's last name or surname. This is the patient's first name, and this is the patient's last name. So it should be Miss Jones and not Miss Angela. If you want to address your patient using your patient's first name, you should remove the patient's title. Here, this person used the patient's surname or last name without a title. That's wrong. Now, if your patient is a child, let's say this patient is 8 years old, you should not use the patient's surname. You should just use the patient's first name. Your statement will now read, I'm writing to refer Angela, an 8-year-old, so it should not be, you should not use the patient's surname in that case. Some letters lack papers. As part of your assessment criteria, your letter should have a clear purpose. Let's look at this letter. I'm writing to refer Miss Jones, a 58-year-old farmer who has been suffering from asthma and is currently being suspected to have pneumonia. She was treated with oral amoxicillin and salbutamol nebulizer. However, her clinical condition had deteriorated. This statement, this introduction, only has a reason. Your introduction should have a reason and a purpose. This introduction only has a reason. It has no purpose. What do you want the addressee to do? This candidate did not document that. So you should be able to document the purpose. You want the addressee to assess and manage this patient. Now let's look at this introduction. This introduction is not very clear. This person said, who was diagnosed of asthma, hypertension, and depression in so-so-so date respectively. She's being referred. Yes, the GP, you'll be managing these patients for asthma, hypertension, and depression. So that's not the reason why you are referring this patient. It's because the patient, you've tried treating this patient frequent different shortness of breath, thinking it's exacerbation of asthma. Now you are suspecting the patient has pneumonia. That's why you are referring this patient, and not because this patient has this illnesses. So this last introduction is not, the purpose here is vague. Now, some candidates write too many details in their introduction. This is the first part of the case notes we'll be discussing. And here, this candidate wrote, thank you for seeing Miss Jones, a 58-year-old farmer who was diagnosed of asthma, hypertension, and diabetes in 2002, 3, and 10, respectively. She presented with a 3-day history of fever, dry cough, runny nose, wheeze, and chest pain. She was then treated with amoxicillin and salbutamol, but there was no improvement. Therefore, she's being referred to you for further assessment and management via the accident and emergency department. This introduction has a good reason and has a good purpose, but it contains a lot of details. You should know you'd write your introduction like this. Listing all these signs and symptoms can be summarized like this: currently having signs and symptoms suggestive of pneumonia, and again, you saying via accident and emergency from the address, this would have been documented that the addressee is in the accident and emergency, so there's no need repeating it in the introduction. Some other errors that some candidates make. Are this, oh sorry. After writing the heading, they write the after writing the heading, here in the heading, the candidate wrote the name and the patient's age, which is cool. But coming to the introduction, this candidate repeated the patient's age again. This is not cool. This is not okay. You've written the patient's age. You should not come here and repeat the patient's age again. But if you use date of birth, you can actually repeat the patient's age. Now, this candidate also used woman here. For crying out loud, this patient, we use the title Miss Angela. A man cannot be Miss. And here you also say Miss Joan. A man cannot be Miss. So there's really no need you saying woman here. We've already known that this patient is a woman. So if you are looking for a noun that you want this adjective to qualify, you can use the patient's occupation. So you can say a 58-year-old farmer. So like here, this candidate wrote the patient's name only in the heading without writing the age. It's okay because this candidate wants to use the patient's age in the introduction, which is okay. But what is wrong in this introduction is this transferred. This is a referral letter and not a transfer letter. Although in the healthcare setting, we tend to interchange a transfer letter with a referral letter. We do use them interchangeably, but in the real sense, they don't mean the same thing. If you are referring a patient, you are referring a patient for the addressee to serve a particular purpose. In this our case, we've been managing these patients for asthma, depression, and hypertension for years, but now this patient has pneumonia, and we could not address this issue. That's why we are referring this patient to the casualty officer to address this issue for us. When this illness is resolved, the patient will come back to us. So in referral letter, in referrals, the patient comes back to you. You are the owner of the patient. It's not the person you are referring the patient to. But in transfer letter, the whole patient management is taken over by another healthcare provider or another healthcare facility. So in that case, you are no longer the person managing this patient for the hypertension, the depression, and the asthma. So the whole patient care is taken over by another healthcare professional, and the patient is not coming back to you. In most cases, we have such scenario when a patient is leaving from a city to another where he cannot come back to you, so the whole patient care will be transferred to another healthcare personnel or healthcare provider. So you should learn to know that there is a difference between a transfer letter and a referral letter, and you shouldn't use these terminologies interchangeably. So if you are giving a transfer letter, you say transfer. If you are giving a referral letter, you use refer. So don't interchange them. So this should have been referred and not transferred. So I think that's all we can take today. In our next tutorial, I'll be discussing the content and structural errors in the body paragraphs, and I think that will be the end of this series. So well, if you've been following my channel, I don't think you have issues with your writing. However, if you don't think you still want your writings to be assessed and you want your speaking to be assessed, you can contact me using this mean this using my Gmail and my Telegram or WhatsApp number. Thank you very much, guys. I really appreciate you listening to me. Bye.